And I'm going to exercise my prerogative as a facilitator to request Mr. Wajahat Habibullah to be the opening speaker. Mr. Habibullah is the chairperson of the National Minorities Commission of India. So he occupies a very major national official position. I'd also just like to say that in addition to the position he occupies, because of his commitment and his integrity, he's hugely respected across India. So I invite Mr. Wajahat Habibullah to start the session with this speech. Mr. Habibullah.
Mr. Rajmohan Gandhi, guests and friends, I'm deeply honored to have been asked to attend this democracy dialogue. I have been an old friend of Rajmohan's, and my wife, of course, is an even older friend, having been part of the MRA and part of the team that raised funds for setting up this Asian plateau. Today, of course, the subject is one to be dear to my heart also. And it is an issue on which I have worked through much of my career. Trying to see that democracy becomes more real for the people of India. We are, and we flatter ourselves and pride ourselves on having been the world's largest democracy. I would like to believe that we are increasingly becoming not only the largest, but one of the world's foremost democracies. Despite what my friend Rajmohan described us as being, an organized anarchy. I think a democracy in many ways is an organized anarchy. It seeks to bring together the interests of all its constituents, who are each and every citizen, and bring about a governance on the basis of serving the interests of each one of us. Obviously, that is a prescription for anarchy. And to organize that is what a democracy actually does. I will begin by quoting from Mahatma Gandhi. The real Swaraj self-government, and this is written before we had actually emerged into democracy, will come not by the acquisition of authority by a few, but by the acquisition of capacity by all to resist authority when abused. Acquisition of capacity by all to resist authority when abused. This clearly states every citizen in a democracy has the right to resist the abuse of authority. And therefore, what does democracy require? And this has been clearly identified in India's own legislation. A legislation which I had the honor to be able to administer the first 5 years of its enforcement, the Right to Information Act. Democracy requires an informed citizenry and transparency of information which are vital to its functioning, and also to contain corruption and to hold governments and their instrumentalities accountable to the government. The last sentence, I think, is the essence of a democracy, which means that every citizen becomes a participant in government. Now, we have been a democracy for 63 years. Is democracy real in the manner that I have described for every one of our citizens? In many ways, no. And perhaps you may say, it will never be real in that manner. But as we described yesterday also, democracy is an evolving process. It will continue to grow. All that we can do as citizens, as an organization, as a part of this process, is to try and see that this growth is not impeded, that there is no setback, but it is allowed to expand. In India, we pride ourselves, as I said, on being a democracy. On our spectacular economic progress in the last few years. Yet, employment growth in India, which was 2.1% in 1989, had dropped to 1.84% in 2004. But nevertheless, because we are a democracy, we have now launched an employment guarantee program, seeking to address this issue, seeking to ensure that this prosperity does flow to the poor, to those who are unemployed, employed at a rate which is growing and not falling. Is this going to answer the problem? Can I say, even has this experiment been successful? You will, over the next couple of days, hear from the practitioners themselves how, in certain respects, it has been successful, because the practitioners are here among us. But in many respects, it has not been successful. Yet the effort has to be made. And that effort, I think, is the essence of democracy. In our economic development, we've gone in for public-private partnership. But the institutional reforms to regulate that partnership have still to find full root, with the result that there is abuse. Access to justice. Is justice accessible to all in our country? We have spectacular judgments of our Supreme Court, which have become the foundation of our democratic structure, which have held governments repeatedly accountable, recently have resulted in arrests of top-level ministers of the government who are under trial, facing trial. But is this accessible to all? We have a system of panchayati raj, local self-government, a system which I have sought to try and administer as Secretary to the Government of India in that capacity. But is it even now accessible to all? Has it replaced the old system of justice which has survived for centuries before it was disrupted in the 200 years of colonial rule? All this requires not only that democracy will result in elections being held. As we are still to discuss, an election held does not necessarily mean the best man is thrown out, or the best party to govern is thrown out. That must continue to be held accountable. Therefore, in India, we have a number of organizations, like the organization which I head, the National Commission of Minorities. We have a commission for scheduled castes. We have a commission for women. We have a commission for women. We have a commission for children, for scavengers, for scheduled tribes. You have all these organizations. The structures are all there in our country. Are they working? And for those who are emerging democracies, and you will hear from one of the guiders of one of these emerging democracies this morning, need to know that a democracy will not attain perfection. But all of us can continue to try to see the instrumentalities of governance, which are part of that democracy, those instrumentalities which are appointed to preserve and build on the interests of the common man, that those actually deliver. I think, in closing, I will repeat what Mahatma Gandhi described as the seven deadly sins. Any one of these would be fatal to a democracy. And the results of these can also be seen in the functioning of several of our democracies. Wealth without work, pleasure without conscience, knowledge without character, commerce without morality, science without humanity, religion without sacrifice, politics without principle. Thank you.